speaker. And our speaker today is Colin Miller. You can introduce yourself because we do have some new faces here. But our special guest and speaker is Bishop Joseph Williams. Bishop Williams has been a good friend for a number of years. We've shared some caritas together. So I've benefited from his wisdom, his insight, and I know that he will too.
And what is caritas?
Caritas.
As a prelude to the...
Is caritas is charity lived out among brother priests. So we do have a sense of community. And we don't get we always get a date, and we all have to like cancel because of funerals and other commitments, but we do try. So, but I think you'll enjoy the topic. You know, we've talked, I think the previous conversations have been, as we say, provocative. In other words, provocative, calling us towards conversation. And I think you'll find that this evening as well. And so we open our minds and our hearts, and I introduce to you Bishop Joseph Williams.
Okay. Thank you.
And then you guys can take it over to me. You'll start first.
Yeah.
So, thank you, Father. And thanks, Father. We did say this the last couple times, but thanks to Father Tracy for his support for these sessions. Without him, we wouldn't be able to do it. And Bishop has been our bishop since 2021 and is originally from Stillwater.
Yep.
Has served the Archdiocese in a variety of capacities. Most recently, prior to becoming our bishop, as the pastor, and a little while he was our bishop, as the pastor of St. Stephen's in Minneapolis, where he revitalized a community there. And he is known, in part because of that, for his work with the Latino community. And so he is or was the vicar for a Latino ministry or something like that. And he also serves, I think, right now as the parochial administrator for Our Lady of Guadalupe. Is that right?
That's right.
Because being a bishop.
Yeah, it is. Exactly. You got it.
He was bored just being a bishop. So they made him a pastor of a church, too. What else would you like to tell us about yourself?
We're talking about community life. I'm the third of nine children. Of course, when you're born into a family like that, your notion of what community is, what Christian life is really defined by that experience. Paul Tracy, Father Paul, being one of 10 children, I can speak for the Williams family. I'm sure for the Tracy family, it really was a domestic church. It was a life around Christ that had the rhythms, a kind of sacred orarium, if you will. We didn't call it that. Evening meal was sacred in our family.
Yes.
Daily mass for my dad and my mom when the kids grew up as well. And now for my brothers and sisters, you know, that's still a big part. So, so much about what I understand about community derives from the sacrament of the matrimony of my parents, Mary and Gary Williams, and just how well they lived their marriage and how they really did create a Christian community, a domestic church around that love.
Well, so let's, we've talked a lot in the past 2 weeks about some of the basics of Christian community, why Christian community, what some of the problems are, what the state of our Christian community is, but I'd love to get your pulse on this, just sort of coming in. So for yourself, what are sort of the theological touchstones? Why is community a topic in the church worth talking about?
Because that's how God decided to save his people, as a people, not as individuals. And one of my favorite images for the church is the church as the new ark of salvation. We think of the ark of Noah and how that was built to save humanity, if you will, or rebirth humanity through those eight individuals and many, many smelly animals on this one bark or ship, as we might say. St. Cyprian, probably Tertullian before him, was the first to make that association of the church as an ark. But Cyprian, Saint Cyprian, really developed that. It's an ark of salvation, and it came in the context of controversy on whether apostate Christians could get back on the ark. And he took the way of mercy. The church followed him and said yes. So you have this image of this big ship in these tumultuous waters, and this is where we find salvation. This is where we find life, and God wanted it that way. It's messy, but it's God's way of saving his people. So I think precisely for that reason, I think we have to talk about the Christian life as a way of communion unto the house of the Father.
I'm often struck by the fact that we worship a God who is triune, and so he doesn't find who he is apart from relationship.
Wow.
Right? And so and he made us in his image, right? That, you know, how we are God's image is probably an endless thing, right?
Yep.
And so but the fact that we are not who we are without each other seems to me to be exactly one of the reasons that God calls us into the...
Absolutely. Pope John Paul II, you may have alluded to this before, said, you know, the Trinity proclaims that God in his deepest essence is not a solitude, but a family. It's hard to define the Trinity, but think of that for a moment, that God in his deepest essence is not a solitude, but a family. And I think, you know, the theological touchstone from the New Testament has to be Jesus himself. He's born into a family, that holy family at Nazareth, but even when he begins his public ministry, we can conceive, okay, he has to establish the new Israel. Eventually, he's going to need to choose 12. He could have done that just before his Paschal mystery, but he decides to live even his public ministry in companionship with brothers on the journey with him. That's a remarkable thing. And that's an invitation, I think, for us. So talking about what the decision for a community, Christ made that when he looked at Peter and James and Peter and Andrew, James and John, and said, follow me. Invited them, Master, where do you live? Come and you will see. And that first Christian small group is born by Christ's example. Uh-huh. Yeah.
So you are out and around the Archdiocese a lot. What is your sense, and I've been a priest here for a long time, what is your sense for the sort of demographics of community in the Archdiocese? So what's the state of our community life? Where are we doing good? Where are we doing good? Where are we doing well? Where are we falling short? What are the challenges? And I guess I'm thinking, like, also, you know, you can divide that up however you want, but like, there's an older community, there's the youth, there's specific communities like the Latino community, and then there's like middle-aged people like me. Well, how do you see things sort of falling out?
You know, it'd be very different from parish to parish, and with the new movements and communities, they're redefining what community can look like. We'll talk later about a proposal that the Archbishop had for the parish. I think there are real threats. Let's just speak generally. There are great threats against the church as community that come in a virtual world. Let's just begin there. Yeah. Cardinal George, the late Cardinal George from Chicago, beautiful priest, but a very wise man. He came to speak at the invitation of one of my classmates, Father Griffith, to the seminarians. This would be 24 years ago or so now. And he said one of his concerns, he said, the world is more and more connected and less related. Well, think about that for a moment. We're more and more connected, less and less related. That's that threatens or at least redefines community as we know it. The other thing I mentioned, let's just talk demographics, speaking very generally again. I mentioned having 8 brothers and sisters. I have 30 nieces and nephews. My dad is 1 of 8. My mom is 1 of 11 children. And thinking of all the first cousins and second cousins fact, Virgil Michaels, a distant cousin who was once, I think your education center might be named for him, but once walked those halls right here, the great Benedictine theologian and liturgist. But I read something few years back, I think, don't quote me on it, or look it up if you will to verify, but something like 60% of children that are being raised now don't know what a first cousin is, meaning they don't have a first cousin. They don't have parents whose siblings, if they have siblings, have children. Think about that for a moment. It's a remarkable statistic, but that's second nature. And so community was kind of built in for me within a large extended family. And of course, we'll talk about the parish as a community a little bit later. So I think there are threats to community, but also opportunity, because being connected and not related creates a hunger. Not having a healthy or robust experience of domestic church means people are looking for communion. They're looking for places so that the church can be an icon of communio, if you will, in a very special way. There's an opportunity for us to be salt and light for the world precisely in that aspect of community life.
My wife mentioned to me last night that apparently the Surgeon General has declared that there is an epidemic of loneliness in the country.
Wow. Yeah.
So, it's, you know, the Surgeon General said it, right? So you know it's true, right?
Right.
I'm not making this stuff up. And so what you know, for your money, what are some of the major things that have happened, or maybe just a couple, in the last 80 years or something? You know, we mentioned at the first talk, we mentioned octogenarians that I talked to that remember a time in St. Paul where there were six Catholic families on the same block, where everybody was involved in everybody's life. You know, they ate together, they visited each other in ad hoc ways, they shared lawnmowers, they grieved when somebody died, they all went to the same parish school, they cut through each other's yards, all this stuff,
yeah,
right? And so it was just, I'm talking to Father Tracy about it a little bit afterwards, like that, you just assumed that was what life was like, that was just, and now we're very, very far from that.
Yep.
So do you have thoughts about what's happened in society in the last 80 years or something like that?
You know, I'm not an expert on this, you know, sociologically or whatever else. What I can say is my experience serving the Latino community for 20 years about has been an invitation to look at this, to look at my own reality differently. I was just sitting, just a couple of days ago, we were talking about, with a Latino gentleman, the way Latinos do things together as a family, as extended families. So I think part of that is the immigrant experience when you come into a new place. So I served in Hampton, New Trier. Those were German immigrants 3 generations ago. And the parish becomes that place of security. It becomes that place where I can be myself, I can be at home, I can express my culture. So part of what we experience with the Latinos is just that they're a migrant community, at least in the parts of Minneapolis-St. Paul that I have served. And so they'll find the church a locus there of community life, but they're also much more aware of cousins, yeah, uncles, how they celebrate, how they worship. It's not just a nuclear family. There's a greater sense of extended family. So I just, again, going back, if I read some of this many, many years ago, and this is not just 80 years, but the automobile, huge, huge social change.
Yeah.
Suddenly I can drive myself. It started to disperse and to isolate and to create individual units. I think that the cell phone, which is, again, creating a virtual world where suddenly I can be engrossed in this virtual world and be unaware of those immediately in my surroundings. So much as, you know, do what's in front of you, says St. Ignatius. So this is my community tonight. You're my community. But if I'm lost on my telephone, as many of the younger people are, you can be in a group of people and be completely alone. And I think Mother Teresa understood this, you know, probably before the Surgeon General, when she came to this country, she understood that there was an epidemic of loneliness, that they have everything they could possibly want and they're hungry for a relationship. We wouldn't have a series like this if there wasn't a growing awareness that loneliness is a thing.
Yeah.
And that it needs to be addressed. And I think it's happening. I see Paul Ruff, who's here, who works at the seminary and is a psychologist. He's more of an expert than I would be on this, but I'm sure he can say, and there's Father Nick as well, who's here, a companion of Christ. You see the younger generation, just speaking about priesthood or priestly life, Father Paul and I, 20 years ago, we understand we want to be in a relationship. There's a Jesu Caritas group. It's intentional. It's not perfect, as he stated. But the hunger, as we mentioned, the worse things get out there, wherever out there is, the more people are going to seek what they're lacking. They're going to seek remedies for that loneliness. I think Paul Ruff could speak to that at the seminary. The number of ordained in this diocese, at least, that are choosing to live as companions of Christ. My brother, Father Peter, is moderating that priestly fraternity within this diocese. These are priests who say, you know what, I'm a diocesan priest, but I don't want to be alone. I want intentional community life, and they're choosing it. That is a much higher percentage today than it would have been 20 or 30 years ago. So I think the Holy Spirit is beginning to make us aware, and not just make us aware, but as the Spirit always does, to meet the moment with new creations that can remedy some of what ails us. Yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about St. Stephen's, because there's a good instance of the way that the Spirit moved. Tell us what happened while you were there. Tell us the whole story. I mean, I think some of us are, I'm sort of vaguely aware of what happened over there. Tell us the story.
You know, long story short, because it is a long story, you know, I kind of entered in what might be called a crisis transition moment in the church. A good number, a portion of the church actually publicly marched away from the church before I even arrived there. So it was fragile already. You know, it's about 6 months later, another group of the parish left it. So I was kind of left with very little, let's put it that way. And it was sad. It was a real rupture, I think, in the Archdiocese in South Minneapolis for sure. And it was a great challenge for us who were living that. There was a very, very small Anglo community that remained, and maybe 100 Latinos that were coming to a 9 o'clock Mass. So, and that was, you might remember, there's a time of strategic planning. So where are we going to keep our church doors open? And or would we be merged with the Basilica? There are lots of things were on the table. And so I guess we heard the voice of the Lord, you know, the voice that Jesus heard, the harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. The Archbishop used that in his pastoral letter. We heard that, and we had some beautiful first fruits for some efforts of evangelization. So he said, we have to die to one way of being a church in order to be reborn to the perennial way of being church. What's the way of the church that many of us grew up with? Archbishop Flynn called it the come and get it Catholicism. We have what you want or need, the sacraments. You know where to find us. Come and get it. Right? Does that work now? Absolutely not. It may have been okay 50 years ago. It may have been fine 100 years ago. It absolutely does not work. They're not coming and getting it. So we have to do what Jesus said from the beginning, go therefore and make disciples. And so interestingly enough, about that time, so we started to grow, let's put it that way, because we went out and we invited in, we started to grow. Rose French from the Star Tribune, I think Father Kenny, who was the vicar for Latinos before I was called up, they called the diocese, we want to do an Easter story. anytime they do an Easter or Christmas story, it's a softball, you take it. So I said, I'll take it. They want a feel-good story, of course, around the major holiday. So I was happy to invite Rose French, and she saw how beautiful the Latinos were. She said, well, here's what I have in my mind about the Paschal mystery. This was an Easter story. So one demographic is kind of dying away, but another demographic is moving in, and that's the new life. So death to new life. I said, you know, that's part of it. But the real Paschal mystery is dying to one way of being church, as I just mentioned, being reborn to that the perennial way of being church, going there for. So I said, by the way, we're going out this Saturday, you know, for a little door-to-door evangelization. We had about 80 to 100 people. And she said, can I join you? I said, really? She said, yeah. So Rose French showed up 8 o'clock Saturday morning, Palm Sunday weekend at St. Stephen's. There's about 100 of us, started with prayer and praise, then did a little bit of formation, then divided the groups, gave them maps for their section of our parish boundaries, and they went out. And Rose French went out with a Star Tribune camera crew, and we started knocking on doors. And I probably shared this story in a different context, but evangelizations are, you know, that kind of public evangelization is always a bit harrowing. When there's a camera crew behind you, let me assure you, it's even more so. So I was just praying. The first three doors, I think nobody was opening up. And then the third door, they opened up. This beautiful family, Sue Sell and her daughters. And all her daughter's getting married now, and I'll be helping form her soon. But Sue Sell, I said, you know, it's Easter week. We don't bang the Bible. We just want to meet our neighbors. I'm Father Joseph, this is, you know, Jorge Matute, and this is, you know, Blanca, and we're just trying to meet our neighbors. You know, it's Holy Week. We just want to wish you a happy Holy Week and let you know that our doors are open. It's just very simple. And she was very pleasant and okay. And once she identifies as a Catholic, that's a green light. She opened her doors. Oh, can I come in? Sure. Can the camera crew come in? That was the next question. And so modest. So they let us in. It was just a beautiful, the article turned out beautifully. And Rose did a great job. But as we're walking away from that encounter, she opened up to me. She said, you know, I didn't even know the church could be like this. She was a Catholic, baptized Catholic from Tennessee. And I could literally sense the spirit of her baptism resonating with that experience of going out. So that was the initial phase, that, and we had a lot of growth. But 2 years later, so we went from 100 to 300 to 700 after about 3 years to 900 after about 4 or 5 years. So it's just that rapid of growth. But then I discovered, boy, is this all? I wouldn't say is this all there is. The Eucharist is the source and summit, but Christian life isn't just about getting people in the pews and counting the number you have there. And that I was made, I wouldn't say painfully aware, but acutely aware of that when we reprised that same route in door-to-door evangelization probably 5-6 years later, maybe more. This was now the summertime, I don't think it was Easter week. Knocked on a door in that same neighborhood, a woman opened up, also a Latina. And we started talking. I said, oh, we're, you know, from St. Stephen's, we're just meeting our neighbors, and if there's anything we can pray for. Oh, she said words priests would never want to hear. Oh, I used to go to St. Stephen's. Oh, as Bishop Dudley say, how did that happen? How did that happen? So you're asking yourself the question, right? Okay, you used to go to St. Stephen's. And then she shared her story. Now I go, there's a Lutheran church on 18th and, or 28th and 13th Avenue, something like this. And she said, you know, it's a small community. It's a, you know, Protestant pastor. But she said, you know, if I don't go to church on a Sunday, the pastor calls me. I was like, whoa. And now I realized I can't do that. I don't even know who's there and who's not there. After 500, there's no way. And let alone 700 or 900. So then I realized there has to be something more, not just that I know them, but that they're known by God, that they're known by their brothers and sisters. People want to be missed. And they don't call them up to say, hey, why weren't you there? But hey, everything okay? We missed you. Community.
Yeah.
And by God's providence, talking about how the Holy Spirit provides, I had a colloquium seminar in Rome that very year, shortly after that encounter, and met this Don Pigi Parini, who had taken a model of small group community life and brought it into the Catholic Church. And I started in just very seed form, saying, okay, all the newly evangelized, you see the tables you're at right now, they would all be in our gymnasium. Sometimes, like right now, there's probably 300-400 at St. Stephen's, a couple hundred, 300 more at Holy Rosary campus now. Okay, you're gonna have mesas dominicales, Sunday tables. Each one of those tables is gonna have a pastorcito, a little shepherd, that a lay person who has that gift to bring other people together that are maybe more converted, that can witness to a new way of living Christian life, not just traditions from the old country, if you will. And so suddenly they're known. So that one pastorcito is really responsible for creating community at that table to follow up. Okay, if they don't go to Mass or they don't show up on a Sunday, I wouldn't know. But that pastorcito, that small group leader would, and they could, in the name of the church, show that fraternal love and concern, let them know they're being thought about and prayed for.
The more I talk to people about this topic, the more that I hear that there's no substitute for geographical closeness,
yeah,
in terms of your odds of having a substantial community life, and there's no substitute for spending face-to-face time together. And that seems to be your experience as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. And this might be the remedy that the church can offer the world if we find ways to provide that, that are very intentional and that give people the sense of belonging, the sense of being accepted, the sense of being loved and missed if they're not there. And we just don't have it in the Sunday assembly. You know, the idea of coming in, punching the ticket, fulfilling your Sunday obligation, maybe coffee and donuts once a month or something like that, is not enough.
Right.
And I think we're rediscovering that, I would say, and trying to find new ways of seeing what church community can be like.
So are there, I don't want to stay on this question too long, but are there, I'm aware that Latinos have a kind of culture that has still a kind of community habit built into it that seems to far surpass ours already. And so are there distinctives of that way of being community that you think that we can learn from? Do you see what I'm asking? I mean, so
yeah.
So when on Saturday afternoons up in Columbia Heights where I live, there's a park right nearby. And just about every Saturday afternoon when the weather is reasonable, and sometimes when the weather's not reasonable, there will be a big party of about 200 Latinos getting yeah. together and just from all over the place. And I often just remark, like, we don't do anything like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I we have this at St. Stephen's, likewise the park right across the Minneapolis Institute of Art. They would be playing volleyball, you know, 5 days out of the seven during the week, during the summer months, and it would be hundreds there. I don't know if you can replicate that. You can certainly say, boy, we've lost something. It should make us soul search. You see it not just with the Latinos, the Hmong, the way they use public parks at Square Lake, where my family has always gone in the summer to enjoy just refreshment as a family, just big Hmong families playing volleyball. So that sense of extended family is something that I think, you know, it's not, incidentally, I think, at least compared to my experience, that the nuclear family is often stressed in different ways by migration. And so we'll find that the nuclear, you think, boy, they're family people, they're family oriented, they love being together, it's all true. And in spite of that, the state of the nuclear family is very strained, let's put it that way. It needs a lot of healing from machismo in Latin America to the separation of family that happens. Usually the man comes first, prepares the way. And it just creates dynamics there that create and wounds that need to be healed over time. So it's not all roses either.
Sure.
And I think there are ways that they're learning from the ministries that the church, you know, how to have mutuality, how to show tenderness and vulnerability within and communicate is something the church and often Anglo missionaries like myself or mostly laypersons, that's a great gift that they're teaching the Latinos, and it's a both and. But I don't know. We certainly can see how far we've come, because I think we've lost a lot of that. I wouldn't know how to replicate that. Maybe
yeah. Let's all go play volleyball.
Yeah, volleyball. That's it.
Well, so you had a great success story in a parish. Let's talk about the parish. That's the title of this talk. In general, you know, I'm aware just historically that it was a commonplace, you know, in the sort of late 70s, early to mid 80s, to say that the parish church could really no longer be a legitimate center of community life for various reasons. You know, take a look at the Acts 2 church. We talked about the Acts 2 church in the first week, where everyone was together and they were meeting in each other's houses. You can say, well, that's because they didn't have a church yet, but there's something still about being in each other's business in each other's houses.
Yep.
That is true to the Christian ethic. And there are, you know, other intentional communities, in part like the Catholic Worker Movement that we talked about last week, but also like the CCR, the Community of Christ the Redeemer around here, that does a lot of work and have found a lot of central elements of the faith to be livable outside of the parish.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
So wanted to get your thoughts about that. How can the parish be the center of community life for the church,
mm-hmm.
And if so, what changes are necessary from sort of the old model, right? So part of what's mm-hmm. informing mm-hmm. this is the parish model for church is something we all take for granted,
right?
But there was a time before there were parishes, right?
Right.
There in the history of Christianity, there's a time before there were parishes, and there have been times when parishes were less central. And I'm aware that I'm saying this as someone whose livelihood depends upon parishes, right? So I like parishes. And so there could be a time after parishes. So that's a long introduction to get your thoughts about the community and the parish.
Yeah, you know, Cardinal Ratzinger, who became Pope Benedict XVI, was onto this almost before anybody else. He wrote some articles in the 50s in Germany that people found scandalous, that really we're actually half pagan now, he would say, our church. And we already back then, he was saying, it's probably time to say farewell to Christendom. This idea that we're a Christian nation with and a Christian people, where the gospel values are integrated into society, into law, into culture, into parish, that whole fortress church or whatever you want to call it, we have to say farewell to that. It doesn't exist. If we pretend it does, we're going to continue to experience decline. And he said something in a book called Salt of the Earth, an interview with Peter Sewald. He said, it might be time to say farewell to Christendom and to return once again to the church of the mustard seed. That was the image, the language he gave. He said, where Christian life will now be passed in very small communities, but nevertheless very vigorous, that vigorously reject what is evil and promote what is good. So that's the idea of the Church of the Mustard Seed, a la the Acts of the Apostles. Think of Aquila and Priscilla, that little house church, the Domus Ecclesiae that they had in Rome. That was a great consolation to lay people that knew the gospel better than Apollos. We know that because they corrected his kerygma. And they had, the experts would say, maybe two dozen a Christian faithful would be gathering in their home. So that's the idea of the Church of the Mustard Seed. And that particular line of that interview stuck with me already 25 years ago when I was in seminary and understanding that. And so I've made a choice, early on in my priesthood, as I shared over dinner, you don't realize how important community is until you don't have it anymore. And having had a beautiful family, then a great experience at Franciscan University of Steubenville with intentional Christian life, then having my first assignment at the cathedral and in a huge cathedral rectory, I followed Bishop Cousins there. And I was asking him, I said, how is it living at the cathedral? He said, well, it's not home, but it's much. That's what he said. And he twisted things a little bit there. It's not home, but it's much. And he was exactly right about that. So I'm living there with one other priest, and he was very independent, very good to me. We worked very well together, but the kind, you make your own dinner, you go into your room. So that was new for me. So I was discerning the Emmanuel community at that point, but ended up living in a Companions of Christ house. Then for the next 5 or more years of my priesthood, but I always had this sense that I don't want to be a priest alone. I want to be a priest in community. So the same sense that we have to have small groups, we have to be together, we have to know each other, we have to hold each other accountable. And so that's been important. That being said, having walked in one of these, so that made me desire and to really promote the new movements and communities. So that might be the complement to the parish model, and that are proliferating or promoting the Church of the Mustard Seed. And they've come up post-Vatican, Second Vatican Council, all over Europe and the United States. Community of Christ the Redeemer is a perfect example of a covenant community nearby. Emmanuel, that I walked with for 10, 15 years, same. And as you said in a previous conversation that we had, what can happen then to parish is that, okay, you say real Christian life, real intentional, committed Christian life happens there. And the parish then little by little becomes a sacramental dispensary.
Yeah.
Right? I find my intentional community, my relationships, my friendships, my formation here, but I need to go to the parish because that's where the priest is, and the priest brings Jesus through the sacraments. Right. And so, hey, if the parish isn't feeding you, you have to find that. And so I completely not only sympathize, but thank God that the Holy Spirit is always feeding God's children in these ways. At the same time, when you become a pastor then, and you have to say, wait, do I want a committed Christian life versus an ordinary Christian life? In other words, this group here becomes these super Christians that get all the formation in this, and the rest of my people are receiving the sacraments and trying to follow the commandments. You know, in the old days, this was more of a distinction between the religious life, when those were the communities that were keeping the mustard seed alive, the Benedictines, the Franciscans, etc. You had this distinction between the life of perfection, and that's the life they were living, and the life of the commandments, and that's what lay people lived. And it's rooted in Jesus's dialogue with the rich young man. But if you wish to be perfect, go and sell all that you have and give to the poor. Vatican II comes along, every baptized person, there's a universal call to holiness, even a universal call to sainthood. And so we can't accept those distinctions. And what I realize is interiorly, the longer I was a pastor of a church, the harder it was for me to take certain members out to give them something really, really good. And just to be, okay, the rest, they're going to have the programs and sacraments if they want them. And I realized, no, as a father, I want that for all of the baptized and all of the sheep that are here. And how can we create that? And that's where that providential encounter, as I mentioned with Dom Pigi, for me started opening my eyes to see this could happen in the parish. And that was a kind of a watershed moment for me as a priest.
Tell us about some, for instances of how you take, so you have the super Christians in any parish, right? How do you take the rest of us, and not just let us float or settle down? What do you do in parishes to renew life?
Right. First, I would say, thank God. You know, thank God for the new movements and communities and the freedom God has given us to seek the nourishment we need for ourselves and for our families. I think John Paul II, and before him Saint Paul VI, they started seeing a work of the Spirit. So it's not again when you realize there's crises or the church is in bad shape, you don't start saying, "Gosh, I gotta find the solution." You listen to the Spirit. What is the Spirit saying to the church? And you find where that Spirit is moving, and then you react to it. So these small Christian communities in the young churches, like Latin America, like Africa, where parish was either weak or so extended, you had 20,000 parishioners or whatever else, the laypersons were saying, we can create intentional community life. And the bishops and the Third General Assembly after the Second Vatican Council, which produced Evangelii Nuntiandi, the great document on the new evangelization, or evangelization in the modern world, started saying, boy, there's this phenomenon, and it's got remarkable potential. We have to be cautious, because in some instances, they were kind of anti-institutional, and took people out of the parish, if you will, but more and more, you can see, as St. Paul VI lived, and as St. John Paul II went further and further in their pontificate, they're getting more and more not just open but cautious, but really promoting that he said local Christian authorities, that's bishops, that's priests, need to promote these so-called small or basic communities. They have proven to be great centers of formation, centers of evangelization, and authentic community. Authentic community. Again, is authentic community coming once a week to a sacramental celebration and then leaving shortly after? And so he says no, but what we're seeing in the smaller communities is authentic community. You know their name. You pray for each other, you carry each other's burdens, you walk with each other, you actively listen. And so anyway, these base communities were growing, and it was only at the very end of St. John Paul's pontificate where he, in a document called Ecclesia in America, it was a synod of bishops, and then he wrote a document, kind of a capstone document for that. But now he sees this can actually work in the parish, not just parallel to the parish, not just as something that can give life when your parish is just really not alive or the pastor really isn't converted or on fire or whatever else. No, he says, maybe it's time. He says that the parish always needs to be renewed. And I'll just pause for a second, because Pope Francis is on the same page. In his document on evangelization, Evangelium Gaudium, he says, the parish is not an antiquated reality. He says it's very plastic. He says, and with the missionary creativity of the priest and the people, it can take on remarkably new forms, he says, and become a center of constant evangelical or constant missionary outreach. I was like, dang, that's what we did in South Minneapolis. That's what he sees. But many of us would say, is that possible? My parish, a center of constant missionary outreach? But then this is the key line from John Paul II. I'll just go back to that. He says, maybe it's time to see the parish as a community of communities or a family of families and movements. I said, aha, this is it. This is what we had started to do in the gymnasium of St. Stephen's. We have to take it the next step. In other words, okay, the Sunday tables are wonderful, but not everybody's at those Sunday tables, just the newly evangelized. So we took the next step in the parish evangelizing cells. We'll probably talk about that, and we'll talk about the synod. But now it's really empowering the lay people, training them to be small group leaders, to understand that you can shepherd with and under the sacramental pastor this group of the faithful and have all of the things that you were looking for outside of the parish, for example. But that can be done walking with the pastor and dreaming with the pastor on how to be a renewed missionary community. But ultimately, a family of families. So every parish would say, "Boy, I have my small group. I have this group of people I'm walking with. It's not going to be, they can change, of course, but there's going to be formation in those, strong teachings, hopefully, intentional community life, evangelization. Again, often radical evangelization doesn't happen from the parish. If you really want to be missionary, find one of these groups that's just doing that outside of the parish. But we say, again, Father Nick, Father Paul could probably say the same, the longer you're a pastor, you say, "Boy, but do I just want to subcontract that? Or do I want that for all of those that I'm loving and that who have the spirit of Christ in them through baptism?"
Right. We've got about 10 minutes. I feel like you've led us in a wonderful way into the synod stuff and contextualized it for us. Talk to us about, because you're the guy, you're the small group synod guy. Talk to us about what your hopes are for that, and what are misconceptions about that, challenges regarding that.
Okay.
First, I would say this is Archbishop Hebda's dream, and it's a dream of the Holy Spirit that came through the synod
assembly. Think about this for a moment. You're the Archbishop. You have this local church, 800,000 Catholics on paper, 110,000 Catholics going to church every Sunday. That's a difference, right? And that you're going to realize, boy, the church we love needs help. He understood the way of shepherding would be through this synod, all those listening sessions. He wanted to get a pulse of Christian life community in this diocese. He did that. And think of all the 30,000 plus comments and suggestions and things that were collated, and all the voting at the Synod Historic Assembly. Priority number one was cultivating small group ministry in every parish of the Archdiocese. You say, "Boy, okay, that was the Holy Spirit blowing through the people, but confirmed by the Archbishop. He chose that one ultimately to be, it was in the top five of voting, but that was his number one. Why? Could it be because there is a crisis of loneliness, that he has the compassion? His dream was this. Wouldn't it be great if every Catholic were part of a small group?" That's what someone said in one of the comments. He said, "That would be great, and that's what I want." And so this is what we're going to try to do year one. But this is what he's saying. What a remedy. If that dream came true, would we be as lonely as we are now? If we had a robust small group that met weekly or biweekly, we shared life, we prayed for each other, we helped each other in difficult times. I think we had fun together. You know, right, there's recreation, there's joy. It's not just business. There's real love and joy and fun that can be a part of all of this. So I think that's part of his dream, but it takes time. You know, I can tell the St. Stephen story. It sounds so neat and clean. It's a mess. It's a total mess. It's exhausting. We're human beings, and we're messy, and there are conflicts, and we have to refashion this or that group. But if you dream it and you realize how important it is and you love the church, you keep cultivating. And so over 3 years, 5 years, seven, or now 10 that we've had small groups or more, there's a culture now. So I think this is a culture-changing proposition. And so what we have in every parish, and Paul was talking about the mustard seed that's been planted here, but everywhere I go, in some case we have 140 or 110 small groups. In this case, we have 80 people that are great. That's the beginning of something. And if you live those well, and if people find life, and if the lonely find a home, the church grows. And so I think we're not naive about how big a lift this is, but we love hearing the testimonies, and we love seeing the people, because we love our church. And we look around, and I think at the end of the day, we hear the statistics, and our heart breaks. We don't want a church in decline. I guess for me as a bishop now, I have a special compassion for pastors who've given their life to serve Christ. They've dropped their nets like Peter, James, John, and they're working as hard as they can. and they're presiding over decline. And it shouldn't be that way. So before I met Don Pici on that excursion in Rome, I met this Father Mario St. Pierre. Great guy, only spoke French. He was 60 years old, doctorate. He had his doctorate in theology, loved the writings of John Paul II, but he was passionate. And his fundamental conviction is that the church should grow. Look at the Acts of the Apostles. That's why we included that in the pastoral letter. It's not the only index, but if the church isn't growing, then something might be sick in the body or in the vine. And we have to ask, why is that not? So I have compassion, and I want to help brothers. And Deacon Mahalik, and I would say Gizzy, and now Miko is more the small group person per se than myself, but I'm certainly on the team. And basically what we're saying is we don't want to be in decline. We want all the parishes to be a success story, and to realize that the labor of your pastor, of your deacon, of your lay ministers is bearing fruit. And yeah, people will leave the church, but there are a lot of people coming to the church. And what we found through the cells is that this is the vision of John Paul II. It decentralizes the apostolic task. You're saying, no, you can grow your cell, and you can be a bridge to the parish community, where they can finally enter the Eucharistic assembly, which is in our minds that full communion with God, as full as it can be this side of the veil. So I think there's a lot of hope, and there's a lot of work, and there's some, you know, there's a great variety. You know, I was just at a parish, blessed a house at a parish, pastoral house, where they have 50 small groups. I was like, that's awesome. That's a lot. Just live them Lent, see how it felt, see how it could be improved, see who wants to continue. And what you're going to find is that if you stay at it, the culture changes. It just happens. You can't put your finger on it. And suddenly there is this culture of witness, a culture of communio, of real community life, and not just in extended family, but around Christ, around the Word of God, around prayer, or this or that mission. And it's beautiful.
Thanks, Bishop.
Yeah.
Let's take a 5-minute break. Refresh yourselves, go to the bathroom. I'll come around and collect questions, and we'll reconvene in 5. Thanks, guys.
Great.
The first one is, can a Judas be part of a small group? And I inquired about this question, and the gentleman said that what he meant was, people who feel themselves marginal mm-hmm. to the Catholic community, have doubts about their faith, have had issues with the church, things like that. I imagine it can be really hard to think these groups are for me.
Okay. Great question. And this is why we need small groups, because they can be remarkably diverse. And, you know, this idea of decentralizing and the authentic sense of that, in some ways is a more liberal understanding of church. You know, some people say decentralized. Well, St. John Paul II used that word in Ecclesia, but never in a sense of you empower the laity to the detriment of the priest. One of the things I loved about the cells is that you have a father that says, I trust you. And I empower you through this formation to lead with and under me, in a sense. And at the same time, there's this reciprocal, but you're always the Father. And we want to please you, and we want to walk with you as well. And if you want to teach, you can enter virtually into our small group. But that being said, what I found at St. Stephen's, like young adults, okay, you know, and I've been at some parishes that are center right, others that are center left. But the reality is, so much of the culture is imparted by the small group leader, and the priest who might want to say, well, this wouldn't work. So again, at the end of the day, there's going to be a dialogue with the priest. But if I were the parish priest, as I was at St. Stephen's, you could say, okay, I didn't have that in mind, but that's a great idea for the small group series for your young adults. Do it. I don't need to do everything, and I don't need... And so the groups can say, well, we could have a group that does social justice work, and the teaching component of every small group is actually going to be the social tradition of the Catholic Church. We're going to look at different documents or books that were written. We do book studies together in that teaching portion, and that's going to enrich the service of the poor or this. Others could have a Carmelite small group, where actually the teaching component is going to be on the writings of St. John of the Cross or St. Therese of Lisieux, and we just want that to fuel our own contemplative lives, but also this third order Carmelite group that we're a part of. There's endless possibilities for this, and so I would say, you know, the marginalized might be a better way of looking at that. Yeah, if I find myself, well, Pope Francis is saying precisely now we need groups on the peripheries. And so I think my mom mentioned to me at the parish where they are, one of the parents said, I want a small group for parents of children who struggle on their sexuality, with their sexual identity. I said, that is so odd. If I were a pastor, I'd be rejoicing in that. And another Latina that I went to at a parish, same thing. Can we do a same idea? There's so many parents whose hearts are broken. They don't know what to do. They feel like they failed, or they don't know what the church teaches, or how to love their child in this. And it's heavy and it's hard. And everybody goes anywhere but the church around this issue. A cell group that attracted, you know what I meant, that welcomed people like this, walked with them. And even, God willing, someday for those with, you know, sexual brokenness themselves would say, you know what, maybe in with the confidence of their pastor saying, you know, is there a way we can live a small group experience to help carry this cross together? You know, I would love to see that. But the pastor has a lot of that. But I love that question, whoever asked it. I think if it's only the priest and only the Sunday Mass, the culture becomes more monolithic because we have our perspective in this. And at the same time, we're gonna shepherd these small groups, but we don't want to be overly, I would say, micromanaging at the same time.
It seems to me that there's an emphasis in what you're saying on two things that we have to hold together. One is that the small groups, and just community life in general, but the call to reforge community requires that each of us not look for a blueprint or a hand-me-down from the pastor to say, what is your Christian life going to look like? Because the pastor can't do that.
Right, right.
Right? And yep. so you have to be the one who lives the Christian life in solidarity with other people. And at the same time, to recognize yourself as part of the Catholic community, mm-hmm. and attach yourself to the pastor and the sacramental life without needing to be told exactly what to do by him at every moment.
Correct. Exactly. Exactly. Yep. Very well said.
Second question. Can you comment on a seeming paradox? Is it a paradox? That we want a parish to be an epicenter of community with all kinds of life represented, but we also don't want to pull people away from their actual neighbors, so that one might be tempted to diminish parish life to the sacraments only. So this is
the actual neighbors in their neighborhood?
I think that's what it means, yeah.
Okay. Well, this might be why the church, I mean, if you look at the old school parish, it was the place to be. It's where you went to Mass and you had your softball, the entertainment was there, the social life was there. We don't have that. We have friends at school and work in our neighborhood. All of that is wonderful. And in fact, these kind of conversations should make us more people of solidarity in our, you know, like whether it's the national night out. I love those kind of instincts where we have to break the anonymity. We have to be face to face. We have to get to know our neighbors. And so, small group definitely doesn't compete against that. In fact, you know, what we've found is that your neighbors are going to go through very difficult things. Human life is hard. And there can be a way, as if you've done some of the formation, is that, at least in the evangelization cell model, it's you're most attentive to the people that are most suffering in your oikos or in your circle of relationships, which includes one of those circles is your geography. And it just makes you more, okay, can I pray for you? And it's not like, okay, I want to get you in the Catholic Church. It's more like, I want to be attentive, aware, compassionate. I want to find a chance when I can to bring God to you through my prayer, inviting you to trust in Him with your whole heart. And then what can happen in that is they realize, I want what you have. And they start being attracted by the faith and by the joy and the communio, the communion you have in your own life. And it could be a bridge to them to live something. If there's, and again, if we are in an epidemic, our neighbors aren't just all rosy and living great communio in the neighborhoods. They're probably losing that in their neighborhoods. And I think the Holy Spirit always brings us together in general. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's worth underlining before we get to the whole end of this series, and we haven't done it, that what you've mentioned a couple times tonight, Bishop, that community is absolutely essential, but it's also, and we want everyone to do it, so we kind of like don't want to say this part, but it's also like really hard.
Oh yeah, right?
Could you have thoughts?
No. It absolutely is, and that's why it can be easier to be alone. We have to overcome a kind of selfishness in ourselves, the awareness of the other, but we know we're more fully ourselves when we are that way. And so Father Nick could probably speak to this. You're living in a companion household, is that right? What house are you living in?
Our Lady of Grace.
Our Lady of Grace. There are four priests that are there?
Four of us, yeah.
Anything you want to say just about, I mean, it's on the one hand, the priests of your generation are realizing this is the way Christ intended his holy priesthood, and this is what would make me the best version of my priest self, but also they're God willing to have a enjoyment. But there's a cost to that as well. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to share vis-a-vis the...
There is a cost, but I think at the same time, I like what you said, how this isn't about like a social program or like our human solution to creating community, but it's actually getting to be present to what God is doing and the Holy Spirit is bringing up. And so life in community makes even this something as simple as a dinner, like inviting three other people to our dinner, like you don't do anything special. Like
right.
You don't have to like somehow have the most creative, I don't know, new way of explaining the faith or whatever. You're literally having dinner. And that
right.
and the Holy Spirit brings hearts together.
Absolutely.
And so it's something you live rather than something you have to like execute or perform, I guess.
Very, very well said. I love the connection between the Holy Spirit and community life. Scripture scholars, I think you looked at the Acts of the Apostles last week. What you have, there's this explosion of the Holy Spirit at the beginning. If you look at Luke, Acts, for example, same author, two books in one, in a sense, but you have explosion of the Holy Spirit with the baptism of Jesus, and then the effects of that Holy Spirit in his public ministry, explosion of the Holy Spirit over the community through Pentecost, and then you see what the Spirit does. But right away, you get intense community living as a fruit of the outpouring of the Spirit. So where you find the Holy Spirit, you're going to find people wanting to be together and to share a life. So we have to invite the Holy Spirit, I think, just sharing with Paul during the break, at the university. So parish evangelizing cells is one model. It's not for everybody, but it can really work, I think, because of the respect it gives to the priest. It doesn't sideline him. And if he catches the vision, he can be at the nexus of it and help develop it himself. But a university president who is filled with the Holy Spirit says, wait a minute, why don't we have households or Catholic frats on campus, right? He didn't want anyone to fall through the cracks, just like I didn't as a pastor. So he has this beautiful brainchild of having Catholic households. You got a name, Lion of Judah, Sons of God, all these different names. You had your own t-shirts, you had your own spirituality. It was a frat, really, centered around Christ and this or that kind of spirituality, but almost everybody belonged. Nobody was forgotten. And there was even one called the Prods. They call it the Prodigal Sons because they went to the parties and went to the Last Chance Mass on Sundays and things, but they still wanted to be in it, right? So only to say that the Holy Spirit finds ways of bringing people together. And whether it's that not everybody at St. Stephen's Holy Rosary is part of a cell group. There's some that just love charismatic prayer group, others that have a rosary group, but it's really intense and intentional, and that's what John Paul had in mind, a family of families, a community of communities and movements. And as a pastor, you just say, what you'd want to ask, maybe like Father Michael Scanlon did at Franciscan University of Steubenville, do all of these people belong somewhere? If I were a pastor, you know, okay, maybe it's not a cell. Are they part of a Third Order Carmelite group that they're praying with and forming themselves with? Are they part of, see what I'm saying? The Spirit-filled pastor, I think, would have that desire that I have as a pastor, that Father Scanlon had as a university president, to say, we don't want our people to be alone. We don't want this epidemic. We want to bring a remedy to it, but sensitive to what the Holy Spirit's doing and not what I want to do.
Young people. What do you suggest when a young Catholic says they're looking for Catholic community, people who have just graduated from college, 22 years old, and are out in the world trying to find Catholic community that's authentic?
Wow, that is a great question. I asked myself that question almost exactly 20 years ago when I was at the Cathedral of St. Paul. I'm celebrating Mass. And there's lots of young adults coming to Mass. And I'm like, are we doing anything for them? There had been a singles group, but it didn't really flourish, I think, because it was all age ranges. But we got together with a strong group of young adults and created the Cathedral Young Adults at that point. And it's still, to this day, it's beautiful. And now it has other parishes involved, but there are hundreds of people participating in that. And part of it, same thing, can we bring them together? And my heart breaks. I have nieces now and nephews that are the marriageable age. And it's just like, gosh, it's heartbreaking to see. Back in the day, I mean, honestly, I was at, going back to New Trier, German farmer immigrants, when the parish was everything. I think I did more 50th wedding anniversaries and more blessings before knee replacements. I shared that when I left. And so I said, you guys have good marriages and bad knees, is what I told them. And then Lorraine Piney says, well, Father, it's because we're praying so much for our marriages, she says. it was a great line. But the point was, you just go to a barn, a Catholic barn dance. I think of all those 50th wedding anniversaries, half of them or more met at these big social events arranged by the church, by pastors who wanted to make sure that they could find somebody. That doesn't exist, and that's heartbreaking. And my, you know, and again, it can't be what it was before, but that's what we tried to do with the Cathedral Young Adults. We just have to get them together. So I'll give you an example. Theology on Tap, we started, that was 2003. You said we have to launch the Young Adult Apostolate. Let's, this cool thing that's happening in Chicago, let's go into a bar. Let's not even invite them into the church, because some won't enter the church. It's court, or the Gentiles, as we call it now, evangelization. But we would do this. 250 people at Sweeney's, or before it became the Happy Gnome, what was it down in Selby? Anyway, they would pack this upper room. The talks were great. Is that the most important thing? No. The questions were great. Afterwards, them being together, you had some that were really, really converted, and some that just wanted to meet a Catholic girl, or just have a beer and have a fun night and maybe meet some people. And suddenly, you believe that? I didn't even know people still had that kind of faith. Do you know how many marriages came out of this? And for me, that was very consoling, because part of it was, there's an epidemic of loneliness, and where does a Catholic young person find that? So there's lots now. This is on the Archbishop's heart as well. During the synod, someone raised their hand and says, well, kind of a nothing about us without us. We know you're talking about young adults. Why don't you make one of us a head of an office? He said, okay. So we're in the process, as we speak, hopefully we can launch it July 1st, of having a young adult, Catholic young adult office. There's 40 or 50 little, and not from cathedral young adults to Our Lady of Grace has very robust young professionals and young adult groups, but we want to bring them together, and we want to do more things to help them meet each other and come out of that loneliness and realize, you know, life in Christ is beautiful, life in Christian community is beautiful, and you're going to find something there that you won't find on your phone, that you won't find in a bar, well, unless it's a Theology on Tap, or you won't find it, whatever, but I think we need a lot more of that. I'm hoping that this new director that we hire, we hope for a part-time priest chaplain as well. We're taking applications, Father Nick, if you have any, all that extra time you have as a parish priest, yeah. I'm sure. But we do, we want to find alignment with that and helping your children and grandchildren find that community life that, again, and it's harder, so just going back to the parish, that might be one of those things, it's almost virtually impossible for every parish to have a super robust. We need more cooperation in regions and clusters of parishes. We're trying this on the West Side. West End did a trip to World Youth Day that we couldn't have done as individual parishes. And I hope this person creates more alignment like that, because more things will happen. Yeah.
All right. I think we should stop putting the bishop through his paces.
There it is.
Thank you all for coming out. Next week, we will have Leah Labresco Sargent here. Leah is the author of a book called Building the Benedict Option, which is about building Christian community. And she'll be talking to us about how to build thick Christian community, but she'll be giving us a whole lot of really practical stuff that you can take home with you and say, all right, I'm just an ordinary Christian dude or dudette. And so what can I do in the next month to practically build Christian community? So thanks, guys. Come out next week. We'll let the bishop have any last word he wants.
Just that your pastor liked the word dudette. You got a chuckle out. Maybe we could finish with a prayer and a blessing. How about that? Why don't we stand together? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. We thank you, Father, for this night, this holy season where your Son leads us into the desert to be with him, to be quiet, so that we can hear your voice in our lives and tune out other voices that are speaking to us. And we ask for a new outpouring of your Holy Spirit, especially here at the Parish of the Assumption. We trust that where your Spirit is, true communion of life will happen. We ask a special outpouring of the Holy Spirit on those newly formed small groups here. May they truly be a mustard seed of full, joyful, and missionary Christian life, and grow into a great, large tree where many people can find a home in those small groups and in this parish of the Assumption. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Okay.